in your book, it's not on the screen. We will go back and start with our SPOS projects. And that first tab is SPOS 7 projects.
Paige, did you put those, the full list in there?
Yeah, they're all in there. I just broke them down. If you'll tell me what page you're on, or tell them what page, tell them title-wise what page you're on.
The analysis SPOS project list?
One page over.
That's the bar chair.
Seven projects.
SPOS 7, Ken?
Oh, okay, got it.
So Mike, the only difference they have is they've got this sheet on top of it.
Okay. If, several years back, Mr. Creech challenged me to go back all the way to SPOS 1 and find all of the projects that had, at some point or another, made it to a SPOS list and develop a computative list of all of the projects that had been on there that never got built, for lack of better terms. So what you got here is you've got all of the roads that were at one time either on a project list, all of the roads, you have the projects that had been brought forth by commissioners, all of the projects that, places where we've got petitions to pave roads, so on and so forth. So there's about 80 projects on the list, and you know, about $115 million worth of projects. So that, I mean, there's, I mean, that's the you know, the big pie in the sky type list. That's the big list. And if you flip on over to your next page, you've got the SPLOS 7 list. This is kind of, this is where we're going to be for the next 2 years, because we've got 2 years left in SPLOS 7.
That's going to be your short list this week.
That's the first page.
Yeah.
We've got some resurfacing that we're going to do both years. And, you know, Commissioner, you asked about that, the difference between the $81 million and the $92 million. Well, right now, with the LMIG, the way it's set up now, the DOT's giving us a little over $1.1 million. We got to match 30% of that. So if T-SPLOS passes, that match goes down to 10%. So that's where your additional monies are coming from there. So there's your list of the roads that we plan on completing with what money we have left in SPLOS 5. I mean SPLOS 7, excuse me.
And this out here is Simpson.
This out here is Simpson.
Now, does it, Bill, does it cross over and tie in something?
Ties in the shallow road over there.
Okay.
Comes around and picks up Frank's Creek Road over here.
And it changes names up here.
Yeah.
Parker.
Well, it's actually here.
Yeah.
And then Parker goes out and picks up shallow road out that way. So three points that it'll tie back into Bay Road.
Good.
So that's the Simpson and Parker project. Phillips Road East, that's just to finish up that paving out there on the other side of Rocky Ford.
Thank God.
And if the weather cooperates, we should be there in the latter part of March, first April. And that's what we've been telling her for over a year. We'll be there in the spring of 18. That's where we're heading. Then we've got Terrace Wood Drive, which is over off of Stateville Highway. It's one of those subdivisions that we've already have the right of way in. It's a long cul-de-sac road. Got good ditches, good drainage, and it's going to be real easy.
Where is it?
Right down there by Ellis Trading Post. Before you get to the trading post at the county line.
Okay. East of Ellis.
That's right. That's right. And then finally, Cannon Drive, which Cannon is the second part of that Cannon, Danelli, and Peyton, all that area down there. This is the last part of getting all those roads down there paved. So that will finish up Splosh 7. You know, we talked about T-Splosh earlier. We went through all those projects one by one. So if you, and again, this is the vote in May. And providing that, you know, if this vote was to pass in May, and there's a Splosh 8 referendum, which will be coming up, you know, sometime in 19, and Mr. Pritchard had asked me to come up with a road list for Splosh 8, something that that we could work on with Splosh 8, and there's the road list there. And then kind of the next page is kind of a combined Splosh and T-Splosh list. And but what I want you to, the very last page, which will be page 10 there, if Splosh, which is the remaining project list with T-Splosh, is the title of it, the next tab over, remaining project list with T-Splosh. If T-Splosh passes and Splosh 8, if you remember that $114 million list that we started with and 80 some odd projects, now we're down to only having $28 million worth of projects on our project list, of which some of these we know will probably never get built just because of the outcry and the opposition for them. So if T-Splosh passes and Splosh 8 passes, our road project list has been dwindled tremendously. So we'll get a lot of good projects out of Splosh 8 and T-Splosh if they both pass. If you go back one page, the other thing Mr. Pritchard was asking is if for some reason T-Splosh doesn't pass in May, what would be what's the Splosh 8 project list you're looking at? Does that change your projects? Well, yeah, it does. I mean, because there's projects on that T-Splosh list that we need to work on, whether it's with T-Splosh or Splosh, the Clydestone Road project, Clydestone Simpson. Great project, whether it's T-Splosh or Splosh, either one. So there's a couple of them on here. The Hickory Grove Road Bridge, we're gonna have to do that whether it's T-Splosh or Splosh. And Old 41 Widening, we need to do that regardless also. So basically what it does is just changes your list a little bit. So but both of those are, you know, kind of my way I envision this Splosh 8 to look. And it's a moving target.
Yeah. Well, let me add, and Mike kind of too, right? It doesn't necessarily change the list a little bit. It changes the list very drastically.
That's
on the
right.
Roads that you actually are able to get paved in this community. The T-Splosh referendum, that tax period is for 10 years. So looking at the potential for T-Splosh and looking at the potential for Splosh, as Mike has said, we can virtually get every road in Lowndes County that has been requested to be paved. There's still probably some of these, as he mentioned, that may not, because of opposition to start with. Some folks don't want their road paved. But for the most part, we'll be able to get through that $114 million worth of projects. We'll be better than three quarters of the way through that same project. And the point with it is, without it, it's not going to happen. And we'll be lucky to get roads, especially take a road like Old Clydeville Road, and the significance to that, we probably wouldn't be able to get that done in the next 10 years. Just trying to pick up the little projects that we can afford to do at the particular time, primarily because of the cost factor. I mean, would you think that would be a fair assessment?
Mike, while you're talking about these projects, will you go back over the old equipment road bridge and discuss that
last year, well, back a couple years ago, the county started moving forward with getting engineering design work done and CSX permitting for the old Quitman Road overpass that goes over the CSX railroad track. Last January, we received a letter from the state that they wanted to pick up that project and fund it 100%. The only thing that we would be required to do is to do the right of way on it. So we said, hey, have at it. Yeah, I mean that's a big ticket item that gets off of our plate to be able to pave other roads and let them deal with the railroad, let them get the permits and everything else like that. So January they took it over. They told us 3 years from last January. So we're looking at a 2020 type time frame for doing that bridge.
They initially looked at it as an overpass.
Right.
And some of the property owners in that area did not want an overpass. They wanted a grade crossing.
No, they originally looked at it as a grade crossing. And the property owners wanted it as an overpass. So that's what the DOT had planned on doing, was going back in there with an at-grade crossing, but the property owners wanted to go with a overpass.
And that was understandable. I mean, again, from what their analogy was, is that from that area, you've got two points of egress primarily now out of that area, and that is the old Quitman Road and the Owsley Road. Owsley Road already has a grade crossing on it, so potentially if the tracks were blocked on both ends, then we could have an issue with emergency vehicles quickly accessing, or if there was a need for evacuation from a forest fire, or whatever the reason might be, it could impede that. So with that suggested, then we begin to look at the overpass situation. But fortunately, we had Transportation Board Member Tim Golden brought Commissioner McMurray in, and we toured some areas. And out of that tour, I believe, is where the commissioner himself made the decision that they would pick up the cost of that bridge. Because again, as we've documented, it is the oldest bridge that we have in Lowndes County that's in the inventory right now.
That's right.
Are there any questions about specific projects and breakdown on that?
Deerfield subdivision.
Yes, sir.
Five roads.
Yes, sir.
That includes the route.
That includes route, yes, sir.
Okay.
Subdivision, we want speed bumps. The county's got a policy and an ordinance prohibiting speed bumps in subdivisions. I talked to Mr. Pritchard, and we're kind of trying to look outside the box. What can we do to these subdivisions where these people want speed bumps? And so I found these traffic logic, they're speed humps, and they're you can still go over them at 15 miles an hour, safely. They're only about 4 inches off the ground, at right at the top, and it's more of a a smoother transition than it is where you come up to a speed bump where you actually got to stop and, you know, ease over it. That's right. So we've looked at these. You know, they come in basically like a jigsaw puzzle, and what we, Robin and I, have talked about, what we talked to Mr. Pritchard about, is these, you know, these things can be put down and they can be removed. They're put down with bolts, you know, the anchor bolts that are anchored into the asphalt, and then they're they have they can be taken up if we resurface the road and put right back down. So what we kind of are proposing for consideration is to be thinking about doing a, you know, amending the thoroughfare plan and the ordinance to allow you know, these speed humps. And basically, just like the drainage situations that we have, if you have a drainage problem, you know, you pay half, and you know, you pay for the materials, we'll provide the labor. If the subdivision wants, you know, speed humps, they can buy and we'll install them. And then when the road gets to a point that it's got to be resurfaced, we can take our truck back out there, we can pull them up, and road can be resurfaced, and we can put them back down. But the, you know, if a subdivision or a community is serious about wanting speed humps, we have an option now. But, you know, you have to bear some of the expenses. And, you know, of course, if, you know, just say subdivision at Page Lift, and, you know, if they wanted to sit down and talk about, you know, their homeowner association wanted to put them in there, we sit down and figure out how many of them I thought that they need to put in there, where they need to put them. And then whenever that homeowner association writes the check, the county will buy them, get them delivered, and then we'll install them. And I mean, that beats the alternative of always having to say no.
One size?
Yes, sir, they're one size.
Now this would, just for a point of clarification, but I can see where this would go, and using these two subdivisions as an example, this would have to be on a county-owned road in a subdivision such as Grove Point, not in a subdivision such as Stone Creek.
That's right.
That is a private gated community.
That's
right. Do what they want to. They're in charge of the maintenance.
Well, they are. I mean, they own the road. We have nothing to do with the road. Right. So yes, that would have to be made real clear, is that it would go onto a county maintained road inside of a subdivision.
Right. They were going to
Or Kingston, they could buy them and pay us to install them if they wanted to, right? Or you could just cut them out altogether.
No. I want to be the one installing them, because I want to make sure they're installed right with our guys, and you know that they're properly installed. I don't want the homeowner association out there installing.
No,
them.
I agree.
What kind of
cost for one set of them?
They're $3,200 for one set of speed humps. But I mean, you know, they're rubber. They're not going to, you know, they can be taken up and put back down. So they basically got a one-time expense for the speed humps, and they've gotten reflective sheeting on it, so they can, you know, so you'll be able to see them, you know, at night and things like that.
Does that cover both lights?
Yes, sir. That'll cover both lights.
And you can add, you know, if you only want to put in one or two in a particular area, but then as the community or as that development may grow, such as Grove Point again as an example, that's into this what, fourth, fifth phase now? As that phase moved, then you could add more into it.
I think it makes perfect sense. I know a lot of communities have went into roundabouts, but the state do discourage the bumps because of the emergency vehicles, the emergency wagon basically. That's why they came up with the rule about discontinuing the speed bumps, because emergency wagons get up to it, or they bump the person in the back, shoots the seat, type deal. So I think this is a good alternative if you want to go to work. But like I said, still,
Well, I think, yeah, and of course it just gets into a whole lot of discussion, but I think from the standpoint of roundabouts, that more becomes an initial design process, especially in a subdivision, that if you choose to go with roundabouts as a safety concern versus the speed hump, then that should be something that should be designed on the front end rather than on the back end. This is a back end solution to traffic control to some degree in existing subdivisions.
That's right. And, you know, and if a developer was developing a new subdivision and he wanted to bear this cost up front to put it in there,
Yeah, we'll go out right now. Oh, you're right. Made
that real clear. He's
traveling for snacks. I guess what I'm saying is technically a speed bump is still a speed bump.
Yeah.
Whether it's rubber or not. But at the end of the day, it's about trying to, you know, you won't slow down the traffic.
Yeah.
You can't take one of those conventional speed bumps, what I call the speed bumps, where they just come in and put asphalt down, you know, 8 inches high. You can't take one of those at 15 miles an hour without tearing your car. And
2 foot wide, 8 inches high.
Right. And
you got a person speeding, they won't be speeding until they hit something that they can slow down.
And I mean, this is over a 7 foot, you know, you're going up 4 inches and back down 4 inches over 7 feet.
You got to have four wheel drive to go over one year country club. That roundabout.
Well, I appreciate it. I think it's a great idea, and I like the fact that now we have an option, and you can be real clear with the development. Like I said, we can sell them up front to the developer, and we can sell them to existing subdivisions. It's an option.
But at this point, this is not even an option unless we address the ordinance itself and change that, amend it to allow for this.
Let's do it.
I guess when we do amend it, we'll put it in such a way that it won't be an exclusive, I guess, item to purchase from just this company, though, I guess. Like, say if we bid it out, or they're the only company that makes these.
We're buying and purchasing it, they're paying for it, and we install it.
Yeah.
So the language would be
that
to the effect of the dimensions of this type of.
We'll work all that out with the attorney, and we'll figure out with the attorney exactly how we need to address all of it, how we need to do that. So
basically, we won't have a sole provider, I guess we're going to do that. Only one company we can get them from.
That wouldn't be in the ordinance anyway, then, would it?
No, I don't think it would.
It'd just be at the discretion of the engineer.
Right. Or us when we vote on buying them or whatever.
The next item I'd like for you all to look at is under the road.